Welcome to our service here this morning at Leamington Baptist Church. Welcome if you're joining us online this morning or joining us later on Facebook Live. We thank you for being with us. A couple of things I wanted to draw your attention to. Many of us shared a lovely meal together after church last Sunday, and it was good to see many people stay. Food is good for our bodies, and it's also good for fellowship. So Wednesday after next, so in 10 days' time, will be our church meeting on the 22nd of March. Rather than have a meal, for another reason that I will explain in a moment, we're going to just have cake and tea and coffee from 7 o'clock, so for 30 minutes, before our meeting starts at 7:30. Anyone is welcome to join us for that time of fellowship. Church members, please note the date. It would be lovely to have a good number share the meeting with us as we consider some church business. So last time we did this, we had positive, overwhelming abundance of cake. So to save some of us having to dutifully eat up the leftovers, which was a pleasure. I've put a sign-up sheet in blue, this is important, at the back, suggesting that perhaps four people will bring cake or cookies of some sort to share with us at 7 o'clock. There may be a few expert coffee pourers and expert dishwasher runners who might kindly volunteer for those tasks. Because, do you know, I honestly haven't a clue how many tea bags to put in a teapot to make decent tea. So if I'm making the tea, you won't want to drink it. So if you're able to help on Wednesday week, the 22nd of March, in some way, the blue sheet in the middle at the back is for you. A little further ahead, on Maundy Thursday, we will have a meal together. You're welcome to come, obviously, and please bring friends. We will use a little bit of Passover liturgy, not a lot, but a little bit, and we will share communion as part of that meal, as Jesus did with his disciples on Maundy Thursday. So it's kind of a mixture of things. We've done it before, and it's always been a really happy occasion. It would be so helpful to know approximately how many people are coming. So because in my head, Maundy Thursday is purple, there are two sign-up sheets. One, if you can come, please sign up. And if you are prepared to help in some way, if lots of people do a little bit, then nobody gets super exhausted by it. So we can share the workout, whatever you feel able to do. Please sign up in the boxes at the back, and we'll have a lovely time. Please invite friends, friends from other churches, or friends and neighbours, anybody. It would be a good chance to begin our Easter celebrations together over a meal. Right, that's enough of all that. If you haven't read the notice sheet, Steve at the back has a few paper copies. You should have had it by email if you are on email. It's there for you to read. And I've written a little piece hinting towards some of the things we're thinking about this morning. This lovely walk in Samaria that Jesus did, that Ruth will be talking about later, has the Bible reading has all sorts of elements to it. And we're just going to hint at a few of those on our way through the service this morning. What I've been considering is worship. So for our call to worship, John chapter 4, verse 24, Jesus declared, God is spirit, and his worshippers must worship in spirit and truth. Let's just be still for a moment, and then we'll do that. Father God, we ask that you will fill us with your spirit this morning, that you will speak truth to us in our hearts and as we listen to your word and as we listen to Ruth expound it this morning. We pray you will give us a fresh understanding of you, of who you are, of how you love us, and what you ask of us. As we come before you as your creatures in humility this morning, we ask that you will fill our hearts that we may worship you, to give you your worth in what we sing and say and think as we meet together. In Jesus' name, amen. So we have three songs to start our worship this morning. Stand if you're able. If you would like to bring prayers of worship between the songs, please do. Let's stand and begin with, let everything that has breath praise the Lord. Let's do that together. Thank you. By its very being, worships you. Father God, we ask that our beings will glorify you as we bring you our worship this morning. Amen. Psalm 148 calls all of creation to praise God, and our next song is based on that. Reaches of heaven, starry heights, oh praise his name.
Let them praise him, praise him.
Heavenly Father, as we declare your praise, we ask that you will show yourself afresh to us this morning. Father, we know that you see right inside us. And so, Father, we pray that you will open the eyes of our hearts to see you. Amen.
Open the eyes of my heart, Lord. Open the eyes of my heart. I want to see you. I want to see you.
Be seated. We want to see God this morning. We want to hear him speak to us. And we want to know just how much he loves us. John 4, verse 29. The woman said, "Come, see a man who told me everything I ever did. Could this be the Christ?" And our hearts cry, yes, it's the Christ. It's the one who knows us inside out. He knows our hearts, he knows our weaknesses, and he knows our failures. So as we come to a time of prayer, we begin with quiet confession. Let's search our own hearts as the Spirit shines his light into us and bring before him the things that we regret this week. Let's be quiet, and then in a moment we will pray a confession prayer together, which will be on the screen, but let's be quiet first. Creator God, you made us, you love us, and you know us inside out. You know the struggles we face in seeking to walk rightly with you. And Father, we know that if we confess our sins, you are faithful and just, and forgive us our sins, and make us completely clean again, that we may stand before you as we try to love and serve you in our daily lives. And so, Father God, we bring you our confession this morning as we pray together. Almighty God, to whom all hearts are open, all desires known, and from whom no secrets are hidden, cleanse the thoughts of our hearts by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit, that we may perfectly love you and worthily magnify your holy name, through Christ our Lord. Amen. And now Simon's going to lead our prayers for others.
We're going to pray for others, as Christine has said, but we're going to do it interspersed with some verses from a song. As water to the thirsty is the song. So the verses will come on the screen and the band will lead us, but I think probably wiser we stay seated and we sing these words and let the words lead us into prayer. I'll open first. Lord, that little confession that we just read said that it's by the inspiration of your Holy Spirit that we can praise you. It's by that infilling life of your Holy Spirit we can know you. We can worship you. It's by that infilling of your Holy Spirit that we learn to sacrifice all to you, that you might have a physical presence here today in the actions that we take and in the words that we say. Lord, even now as we come before you to pray for other people and other situations, we pray again that we would be thirsty for that infilling of you that inspires us to bring others before you in the way that you love them yourself. Lord, quench our thirst, we pray, as water for the thirsty.
As water to the thirsty,
as beauty to the eyes, as strength that follows weakness, as truth instead of lies, as song time and spring time, and summer time to be, so is my Lord, my living Lord, so is my Lord to me.
Father, we know that any strength we have is your strength, that any truth that we understand is your truth. You are perfect strength, Lord, you are perfect truth. And as we read those words and sing those words, we think of the situations around the world, Lord, where that strength of character which we have seen in you is so lacking. where that honesty and uprightness that we see in you is so lacking. And yet, in the moment we say these things, we know, Lord, that we are not here to judge. But we ask, Lord, that you would give strength. Give strength to those who are called to lead us as a nation, be they royalty or be they elected politicians. Lord, stir the hearts of people in positions of responsibility to be hungry, not for truth to serve merely their ends, but for an understanding, Lord, that there is an absolute truth, absolute righteousness. We thank you that you have chosen that we live in a nation which is peaceful and stable, and we recognize that not every nation in the world is. And yet, Lord, even here, we see what weakness of character and what casualness with truth can do. So we pray that you continue to lead this nation, that you continue to lead this fellowship. Lord, we thank you that your strength and your truth comes with a sense of peace and a sense of calm. So we sing again, like calm in place of clamor. The source of all peace and all calm. Living Lord, the source of peace which far, far surpasses our understanding. We know many who have suffered loss. We know many who physically are ailed. Lord, as we thank you again, we thank you for those among us here who have known your healing hand, and we worship you. We're grateful again, Lord, that there are clinicians and scientists, doctors and carers. But we recognize that their skills are a gift from you. Their knowledge and their ability to investigate are a gift from you. The medication that they have developed is a gift from you. So we thank you, Lord. We thank you, Lord, for the impact that you've had in Stephen's body, in Tom's body, and in others that we could name amongst the fellowship. And we glorify your name because of it. But still, we pray for peace and calm. Peace for those who have operations scheduled, calm for those who are undergoing investigation at the moment, Lord, we take this time to pray for the eldest amongst us who maybe feel frailer and weaker than they once did. Give them the calm that they need to face their circumstance. Lord, and we pray also for the youngest amongst us. Caris and Robin and their families. Lord, thank you that you will take those young lives and that you will shape them to your purposes. We do pray for peace and for rest in those households. Which makes me smile as we open up our last verse, singing about sleep.
As sleep that follows fever, as golden spell of gray, as freedom after bondage, as sunrise to the day, as hope to the traveler, and now we are to see, so is my Lord, my living Lord, so is my Lord to me.
Father, we thank you that through your precious Son, Lord Jesus, as we have already sung and said and thought, you have granted us freedom. Eternal freedom. How wonderful. And yet, Lord, we look across the globe and we see people who believe you, who are suffering in the here and now. Lord, we do pray for your church worldwide and ask that even in the most difficult of circumstances, they would have freedom to worship you and to serve you. Lord, we thank you for the joy of new members in the fellowship, Patrick and Sarah, Alessandra, Paul and Anne. Lord, we trust that you would give them the freedom that they need to find just the role that you have created for them here among us. And Lord, we sang of sunrise. And we know that Scripture tells us that you are the Sun of Righteousness, Lord Jesus. So we continue to pray for all of the different ways and means that we are reaching out to the community around us. We do pray, Lord, that you, the Sun of Righteousness, would rise in lives locally, and that we would see men and women who have not known you come to know you. That we would see your love shed abroad in new hearts. Lord Jesus, we worship you. We pray to you, the only Son of the Eternal Father. And we join in those old words that you taught us and that we have learnt so often. So the Lord's Prayer, maybe in the more traditional wording. Our Father, who art in heaven, hallowed be thy name. Thy kingdom come, thy will be done, on earth as it is in heaven. Give us today our daily bread, and forgive us our trespasses, as we forgive those who trespass against us. Lead us not into temptation, but deliver us from evil. For thine is the kingdom, the power, and the glory, forever and ever. Amen. Amen.
Thank you, Simon. And now Paul is going to come and read scripture to us. I meant to look up what page it was on in the church Bibles. There are Bibles in the chairs in front of you. I'd find it really helpful to follow as someone's reading because I'm hearing and looking at the same time, and I think it helps us take it in. There are an awful lot of elements to this passage, so listen up.
So the reading is taken from John, the Gospel according to John, chapter 4, starting at the first verse and reading the first 30 verses. And it's headed, Jesus talks with a Samaritan woman. Now Jesus learned that the Pharisees had heard that he was gaining and baptizing more disciples than John, although in fact it was not Jesus who baptized, but his disciples. So he left Judea and went back once more to Galilee. Now he had to go through Samaria. So he came to a town in Samaria called Sychar, near to the plot of ground Jacob had given to his son Joseph. Jacob's well was there, and Jesus, tired as he was from the journey, sat down by the well. It was about noon. When a Samaritan woman came to draw water, Jesus said to her, "Will you give me a drink?" His disciples had gone into town to buy some food. The Samaritan woman said to him, "You are a Jew, and I am a Samaritan woman. Ask me for a drink. For Jews do not associate with Samaritans." Jesus answered her, "If you knew the gift of God and who it was that asked you for a drink, you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water." "Sir," the woman said, "you have nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. Where can you get this living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us the well and drank from it himself, as did also his sons and his livestock?" Jesus answered, "Everyone who drinks this water will be thirsty again. But whoever drinks the water I give them will never thirst. Indeed, the water I give them will become a spring of water welling up to eternal life." The woman said to him, "Sir, give me this water so that I won't get thirsty and have to keep coming back here to draw water." He told her, "Go, call your husband and come back." "I have no husband," she replied. Jesus said to her, "You are right when you say you have no husband. The fact is, you have had five husbands, and the man you now have is not your husband. What you have just said is quite true." "Sir," the woman said, "I can see you are a prophet. Our ancestors worshipped on this mountain, but you Jews claim that the place where we must worship is in Jerusalem." "Woman," Jesus replied, "believe me, a time is coming when you will worship the Father neither on this mountain nor in Jerusalem. You Samaritans worship what you do not know. We worship what we do know, for salvation is from the Jews. Yet a time is coming, and has come now, when the true worshippers will worship the Father in the Spirit and in truth, for they are the kind of worshippers the Father seeks. God is spirit, and his worshippers must worship in the spirit and in truth. The woman said, I know that Messiah, called Christ, is coming. When he comes, he will explain everything to us. Then Jesus declared, I, the one speaking to you, I am he. Just then, his disciples returned and were surprised to find him talking with a woman. But no one asked, what do you want, or why are you talking to her? Then, leaving her water jar, the woman went back to the town and said to the people, come, see a man who told me everything I've ever done. Could this be the Messiah? So they came out of the town and made their way towards him. Thanks be to God for his word to us. Amen.
Thank you, Paul. And before Ruth comes to talk to us about that passage of scripture, we're going to sing again, Seek Ye First the Kingdom of God. That's what this passage is all about. God's kingdom coming to an unexpected place. And that place might be Leamington Spa. So let's pray with our hearts as we sing. Let's stand together. Let's pray for Ruth as she brings God's word to us. Heavenly Father, we ask for an anointing of your spirit on Ruth and on our listening hearts as you speak through her to us this morning. Father, keep the evil one at bay and help us to hear what you would say to us. Bring peace in Jesus' name. Amen.
I moved across here. There was a bit of a technical hitch with my microphone, so preaching from here this morning. Can I just say before I start, we're doing this walking through places series, John's gospel, which this one is taken from, was framed in such a way that much of it is conversation with individuals. And if we want to be witnesses for God, if we want to be able to speak to those who do not yet know him, then it's a good study to look at those conversations and those encounters that Jesus had, because we can learn so much of how we can deal and speak with others. Walking through Samaria. He must needs pass through Samaria, or as we read, he had to pass through Samaria. Or did he? Geographically, the answer is no. But by revelation of the Holy Spirit, the answer is yes. One day, I arrived home from work, and as I came in, my father said to me, "You know, Jacob's well is not far from where John was baptizing in the Jordan." I'd had a long and hard day at work, so I cut the conversation short by saying, "I'll go and put the kettle on." But my father had spent 6 years in Palestine as a driver in the army, including as a driver for the intelligence officer. He had become fluent in Arabic, and there was nowhere that he did not know. And when years later he became a Christian and started to read the scriptures, every page, Old and New Testament, was like walking the towns and the villages, the hills and the valleys. I think my love of the history and geography of ancient Israel comes from hearing from him firsthand the context in the scriptures. Now, Jesus had been with his disciples who had been by the Jordan, baptizing those who came to him. But when Jesus heard that there was a debate going on among the Pharisees as to who had the most converts, Jesus left and returned to Galilee. Many times in the Gospels, Jesus quietly slips away when this type of controversy arose about popularity and numbers. He never shied away from debate over the truth with the religious leaders. And at times, Jesus looks very harsh in his response to them. But he shunned popularity for its own sake. What an example for us in this modern day and age, as the religious world is not exempt from the celebrity mindset. Now, the Jews had no love for the Samaritans. In fact, there was almost hatred between them. Why? The hatred went back centuries to a time when Assyria invaded northern Israel 722 years before Christ came. And about 3 years ago, I did a series on the life and times of Isaiah, and we looked at how Assyria, who was then the dominant power, overran and took the northern kingdom into exile. They also moved tribes from other lands into the region of Samaria. As a result of this, the worship of idols and false gods became common in the land of Israel. The account can be found in 2 Kings chapter 17. And in verse 27 it reads, "Then the king of Assyria commanded, 'Send there one of the priests whom you carried away from Samaria, and let him go and dwell there, and teach them the law of the God of the land.' So one of the priests who was exiled came back and dwelt at Bethel and taught them how they should fear the Lord. It says in verse 33 of that chapter, so they feared the Lord, but they also served their own gods after the manner of the nations from whom they had been carried away. By the time of Jesus, the religion of Samaria had become a mixture of different beliefs. They still believed and accepted Moses, but rejected the rest of the Jewish scriptures, and so were hated by the Jews. And it is into this background that Jesus meets with this woman at Jacob's well. Jesus, wearied with the journey, sits down to rest. It is about midday, and his disciples have gone to buy food in the town or village, and he is alone when a woman comes to get water. Now, this is unusual in that society. Women always came as a group, and usually in the cool of the morning or the evening. But she was alone, and it was midday. Jesus said to her, "Give me a drink." A simple enough request. The day was hot, and he was tired on his journey. But she was a woman and a Samaritan. And she replied, "How is it that you, a Jew, ask of me, a woman of Samaria? For Jews have no dealings with the Samaritans." Her words imply surprise, shock, curiosity, astonishment even. But Jesus continues without any sign of embarrassment or prejudice whatsoever. "If you knew the gift of God and who it is that is saying to you, 'Give me a drink,' you would have asked him, and he would have given you living water." Now, Jesus could have said, "You would have asked me, and I would have given you living water." So why does that matter? Jesus was not yet ready to reveal who he was to this woman. He had more to say to her first. We cannot bring people to Jesus when we think we can. Salvation is the work of the Holy Spirit. And until a certain groundwork is done by the Holy Spirit through the Word, a lasting work is often not achieved. But after what Jesus had said, the woman states the obvious, really. "Sir," she said, "you have nothing to draw with, and the well is deep. Where do you get this living water? Are you greater than our father Jacob, who gave us this well?" At this point, the woman and Jesus begin to talk at cross purposes. Jesus is talking about spiritual water, or the Spirit of God. She is still talking about the well and who gave it to them and which is the greater. She is beginning to veer towards a discussion on which culture is greater. But Jesus replies, "Everyone who drinks of this water will thirst again. But whoever drinks of the water that I will give him will never thirst. The water that I will give him will become in him a spring of water welling up to eternal life. Then the woman replies, "Sir, give me this water, that I may not thirst or come here to draw." She is still confused by the spiritual and the natural. "Give it to me and save me all this chore I do every day of fetching water." But then Jesus changes the conversation completely and says to her, "Go call your husband and come here." The woman said defensively, "I have no husband." And Jesus said to her, "You are right in saying you have no husband. For you have had five husbands, and the one whom you have now is not your husband. In this you said truly." That often asks the question, how did Jesus know about her lifestyle? In Isaiah, there are prophecies concerning the ministry of Jesus. Chapter 61 is well known and well quoted. "For the Spirit of the Lord is upon me, for he has anointed me to preach good news to the poor. He has sent me to proclaim release to the captives and recovery of sight to the blind, and to set at liberty those who are oppressed." But there is another prophecy in chapter 11 of Isaiah, not so well known, about Christ's ministry. And in verse 2 of that chapter it says, "And the Spirit of the Lord shall rest upon him, the spirit of wisdom and understanding, the spirit of counsel and might, the spirit of knowledge and of the fear or the reverence of the Lord. He shall not judge by what his eyes see, or decide by what his ears hear, but with righteousness he will judge the poor and decide with equity for the meek of the earth." We too, when we are led by the Spirit of God, and it is those who are led by the Spirit of God who are the sons of God, says Romans 8:14, can know the wisdom, understanding, counsel, and knowledge, and the reverence of the Lord that comes through that indwelling spirit, just as Christ did. The woman sees it straight away. For she says to him, "Sir, I perceive that you are a prophet." Is this the point where Jesus will reveal himself? No, because she goes on, "Our fathers worshipped in this mountain. You say Jerusalem is where men ought to worship." Earlier on in the conversation, she had tried taking it in a cultural direction. But here, she tries to go down the road of a religious argument. This mountain or Jerusalem? This denomination or that one? When I retired from work, one of the things I missed was the often rough and tumble of witnessing in the canteen at lunchtime. Someone would ask a question to deliberately embarrass me. But as I have said, we have a Holy Spirit to prompt us and guide us in what to say. One quote from scripture, or another word of wisdom in some way, and the whole situation is turned around. I never saw anyone come to the Lord in that time, but I know beyond all doubt that those conversations will never be forgotten. In a different time and place, the Holy Spirit will bring them to life when another conversation happens elsewhere with someone else. We can all be links in the chain on someone's journey towards Jesus. Jesus did not sidestep the religious issue. He took it head on. Woman, believe me, the hour is coming when neither on this mountain or in Jerusalem will you worship the Father. You worship what you do not know. We worship what we know. For salvation is from the Jews. But the hour is coming, and now is, when the true worshippers will worship the Father in spirit and truth. For such the Father seeks to worship him. God is spirit, and those who worship him must worship him in spirit and truth. The woman then says to him, I know that Messiah is coming. When he comes, he will show us all things. Then came the revelation from Jesus. He said, I who speak unto you am he. She had said, I know that Messiah is coming. This woman was a seeker after truth. She was a Samaritan. She was also a bit of an outcast in her society. Fetching water at midday alone says it all. But we read earlier, he will not judge by what he sees or decide by what his ears hear. But with righteousness, he will judge the poor. And the first beatitude, blessed are the poor in spirit, for to them belongs the kingdom of God. So what happens? The disciples arrive back at that moment, but the woman was gone, leaving her water pot at the well to tell the village, come, see a man who told me all that I ever did. But for me, the next thing she said has more significance. Can this be the Christ? I believe that she and the others in the village had been going to where John was baptizing and listening to his preaching, joining with the crowds. As my father said to me as I came in, you know, Jacob's well is not far from where John the Baptist was preaching. John finishes the account by telling us that Jesus and the disciples stayed in Sychar for 2 days, where many came to believe, not just because of the woman's testimony, but also because of the words of Jesus. But just before the villagers returned to the well, Jesus had a quiet word with his disciples about reaping and sowing. I sent you to reap for that which you did not labor. Others have labored, and you have entered into their labors. I believe, of course, that Jesus knew what was going to happen. And it was his way of saying, others have done the hard work of ploughing and sowing. You are about to enter into the results of their labour. The work of God is the total of many individual ministries working together. The one thing common to all is that we are his witnesses. Whatever you feel is your calling, no one is exempt from taking every opportunity that God opens for us to say a word for the Lord. It may not always be welcome, but God has an amazing way of turning even our mistakes into his opportunities, which work out for his glory. The Holy Spirit had been at work in Sychar. Hearts had been drawn to the prophet preaching down by the Jordan River. John had prepared the way of the Lord, and Jesus was then able to establish a group of believers in what was hostile country. But Jesus had revealed himself to her, the woman at the well, and she would tell everyone that she met. Now we're going to have a hymn to finish, or not quite. And it's a hymn of praise, a hymn of, it always reminds me, this one, of the Welsh revival. A hymn of revival, just as the woman went and witnessed, there would have been great rejoicing that they had found the Messiah, the one, the anointed one, who was to come. And you know, she's going to be in heaven, and I can't wait to meet her. She was, you know, a searching heart, and she found the Saviour. I will sing the wondrous story of the Christ who died for me, how he left the realms of glory for the cross on Calvary. Let's all sing it. Thank you, Laura.
Story of the Christ who died for me.
How he
Amen. My food, said Jesus, is to do the will of him who sent me and to finish his work. I tell you, open your eyes and look at the fields. They are ripe and ready for harvest. And as I finished my ramblings that went in the newsletter yesterday, Micah chapter 6, verse 8. He has showed you, O man, what is good. And what does the Lord require of you? To act justly and to love mercy and to walk humbly with your God. And may we know his power to do that this week. As we close, let's bless one another and pray for one another with words that are less familiar than what we usually say. So look around now, see who's here, and then we'll read these words together off the screen. I hope. Yes. Now to him who is able to do immeasurably more than all we ask or imagine, according to his power that is at work within us, to him be glory in the church and in Christ Jesus throughout all generations, forever and ever. Amen.